Hi there, Doug Stuman with IT Creations with the HPE ProLiant DL380 Gen11 server, one of HPE's workhorse multi-environment platforms. We did the DL360 Gen11 a while back, and you can see that video here. That one was a 1U platform. This one sits at 2U and offers more storage and expansion options. It too is outfitted with dual 4th generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors, codenamed Sapphire Rapids, for improved performance across the board compared to the previous 3rd generation Intel Xeon Scalable Ice Lake CPUs. There are so many storage options on this 2U chassis that it does get a little confusing. Shall we? This platform can be used for highly virtualized environments, cloud, big data, AI, and a host of other applications. New to the system is support for the NVIDIA H100, L40 and L4 GPUs. I will mention it is also the world record holder for TPC-H at 10,000 gigabyte scale factor, non-clustered. TPC-H is a transaction processing and database benchmark specific to decision support. I'm thinking at the 10,000 gigabyte scale, we're talking about several of these babies just lined up and performing analytics. It also achieved world record performance at the 2-processor level. On another note, it's also the first to surpass 2 million QPH, which is a measure of composite queries per hour for performance, also through TPC-H for database performance. They also go on to say there is a 42.79% increase in performance for this platform compared to previous generation Dell servers that won't be named at this time. It's the Dell PowerEdge R940XA, which is a 4U platform with 2 or 4 sockets depending on if you add the CPU mezzanine for processors 3 and 4. I find the comparison somewhat lacking as that is an older system running 2nd generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors with up to 28 cores each and up to 6 terabytes of memory. Video down below. Not the new, so to speak, 4th generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors with support for DDR5 memory, which is 1.6 times the performance increase, PCIe 5.0 at twice the bandwidth, and improved UltraPath Interconnect 2.0. Specifically, the DL380 Gen11 test platforms were running Intel Xeon 8490H+ processors with 60 cores per socket to achieve those numbers. 2nd gen CPUs only had a top core count of 28 cores. Impressive? Yes. But I find these performance reviews are so cryptic and somewhat unenlightening. Let's take a look at the hardware. Before we get too far along, have you been considering the HPE ProLiant DL380 Gen 11 server? Check out itcreations.com if you are interested in saving up to $500 off a system valued at $5,000 or more that's listed on our site, or one that you can configure. When you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video. While you're at it, subscribe to our channel. You never know when you might need some parts that'll save you some cash. itcreations.com. The HP ProLiant DL380 Gen 11 server offers a number of different storage options with front, mid-tray, and rear drive cages. There's a 3.5-inch chassis with 12 drive bays, a 12-bay and 20-bay EDSFF drive version, a 2.5-inch drive chassis with 24, 8-bay, and 30-bay option, and if you add 6 drives at the rear of the chassis, oh, and you can even add 8 more in the mid-tray for up to 38 drive bays. Of course, rear drive cages can be installed in the front 8-bay version too, bringing the total to 14 2.5-inch drive bays. Drive types supported include Sata, SAS, NVMe U.3, and EDSFF high-density storage devices. There is an 8-bay LFF chassis, but that one cannot be upgraded to support 12-bay LFFs, at least on the front. There are various tri-mode bays depending on the backplane that will support any drive type in that particular bay. There might be 1, 2, or 4 tri-mode bays per storage box, or you can just load up on a specific drive type, again, depending on the backplane. Our system doesn't have any of the good stuff, unfortunately, so no show and tell on all these drive cage options. I'm kidding, we're using Photoshop for this exercise. Did I mention there's an optional bezel? On the front of the chassis, there might be a universal media bay, but only on the 8-bay 2.5-inch chassis. One thing that is pretty consistent is the control panel on the right server ear of the chassis. Well, maybe not if we're looking at the 8-bay LFF chassis. Let's ignore that for now. Starting at the top, power on standby button LED, health status LED, network interface controller LED, and unit ID button LED. Right next to those, an integrated lights out service port at the top with USB 3.0 port below that. On the left server ear, there is a serial number pull tab and drive support label. That drive support label really doesn't provide much information. If your unit comes with that media bay, there is an optional optical device and dual USB 2.0 ports. Our unit came with two blank storage boxes and one 8-bay 2.5-inch storage box. On the back of the server, there are two OCP card slots, one of which we outfitted with a storage controller, specifically the HP MR408i-O OCP 3.0. It's a Gen 11 controller. HPE says this storage controller is ideal for data center environments supporting either RAID or HBA pass-through. It's designed for PCI 4.0 lanes and comes in two form factors, a standard PCI half-length, half-height card, or this OCP NIC 3.0 form factor like this one. This one has 4 GB of cache and can support Sata at 6 GB per second, SAS at 12 GB per second, or NVMe at 16 GB with 8 slim SAS ports. There's even a 24 GB SAS option listed in quick specs, but I have not seen any of those yet. You may have noticed there are no embedded network interfaces on this system. That being the case, the other OCP card slot is an HPE Broadcom BCM5719 OCP 3.0 network interface controller with 4 1-gigabit Ethernet RJ45 ports. This is a low power option, ideal for virtualization. There's really not much else to say about that. The OCP slot will take several other OCP cards offering 10 gigabit, 10 gigabit and 25 gigabit, 100 gigabit, and even 200 gigabit cards, each with various ports and connection options, including small form factor plus, small form factor pluggable 28, and for that 100 gigabit card, dual quad small form factor pluggable 28 offering 28 gigabit per second transfer speeds per channel for a total speed of 100 gigabit per second once you round it off a bit. More options if you go with a PCIe-based network card. Squeezed in between the OCP card slots is the unit ID indicator LED, two USB 3.0 connectors, a dedicated ILO port for managing the system remotely, and an optional serial port with VGA port next to the dual redundant PSUs. Above the PSUs, an optional NS204i-U boot device that can be installed and supports dual M.2 NVMe drives in a hardware mirror RAID 1 configuration. There are other options for booting the system, but this one has rear accessible M.2 drives, which can be useful. There are still options for using an SD card or a USB device to boot the system, but going forward, there has been a change in the way VMware can be installed. Beyond VMware ESXi 7.0, an M.2 or other local persistent storage device will be required. PSU supported include 1600 watts, 1000 watts, and 800 watts platinum or titanium. There are several PCI 5.0 slots above. Those slots also can be outfitted with optional drive cages, which would take out a number of those PCI slots. That integrated lights out port or ILO port on the back of the system enables administrators to access the system remotely using a standard web browser. This platform is embedded with ILO 6 standard with intelligent provisioning to monitor, configure, and update the system from anywhere. That would be to manage this single system. If the system is part of a cluster or a whole enclosure, then there's HPE OneView, also standard, but downloadable. For more features for both of these management suites, you can purchase advanced versions, which do require a license. With the cover removed, you can see just how pared down this particular system is. Only a single riser with 3 slots, and that's pretty much it for PCI slots. There are options for the risers as well. This primary riser comes with either 2x8 slots and a single x16 slot, or 3x16 slots. Both of those options have a x16 electrical connector width. An optional secondary riser that goes in that slot right next to the primary riser. That secondary riser supports all PCI 5.0 slots too, with either all x16 slots and x16 connector widths, or a combo dual x8 and a single x16 slot with all x16 connector widths. There's also a tertiary riser that installs just above the PSUs, and that one has 2 slots with either a PCI 5.0 and PCI 4.0 x16 slot, or all PCI 5.0 and combo x8 and x16 slots. Again, if rear drive cages are installed, they will take out a few of those PCI slots. Supporting the storage up front is a single drive backplane for the 8 drive bays, and behind that a row of fans. If you install any GPUs, mid-tray drive cages, performance NVMe drives, 3 front drive cages, or CPUs with a TDP greater than 205 watts, then you will need the high-performance fan kit. For reference, this platform features the C741 chipset and can be outfitted with CPUs with a thermal design power range of up to 350 watts. Most of those processors will require a high-performance heatsink. Q processors will require a maximum performance heatsink. And now you're wondering, what are Q processors? Those particular processors basically require liquid cooling, so I think we can safely assume the high-performance heatsink is liquid-cooled. There are suffixes on many of the processors which indicate better performance for specific workloads. The platform supports platinum, gold, a few silver varieties, and even one bronze-level CPU. Memory supported includes only registered DDR5 memory modules. DDR5 provides a 60% increase in performance over DDR4. Supported memory speeds of 4800 megatransfers per second are supported with all slots filled with 256 gigabyte memory modules, which will provide up to 8 terabytes of memory. However, I will note that the memory speed will be affected by the processor. That lone bronze processor only supports memory speeds of 4000 megatransfers per second, which is still faster than DDR4 speeds, which top out at 3200 megatransfers per second. Some of the silver and gold CPUs also support a slower memory speed than 4800 megatransfers per second. This system can be outfitted with virtual RAID on CPU key for support of SATA or NVMe drive types. VROC offers software RAID or can be used for HPA Direct Connect drives. The RAID solution is designed specifically for SSDs. An embedded controller will support up to 14 SATA storage bays with limited RAID options. Several other smart array controllers or tri-mode controllers provide additional options for managing the crazy storage options on this system, and you may need two depending on the storage RAID conditions you're trying to achieve. Of course, you could also go with the embedded storage controller augmented with a smart array controller, controllers with a cache that will require a smart storage battery and cable kit, surprisingly like the one we have installed on this system. The platform will support a maximum of 3 NVIDIA H100 80GB, L40 48GB, A16 64GB, or A100 80GB PCIe accelerators. Alternatively, you can install up to 8 NVIDIA L4 24GB PCIe accelerators. The only one that is designed for PCIe 5.0 is the H100 80GB accelerator, and if you have 3 of those installed, you will need the direct liquid cooling kit. It's not even supported if you have the 24 SFF or 12 SFF chassis. It's designed for transformational AI training. In a nutshell, that GPU accelerates pretty much everything and anything for high-performance computing, AI machine learning, scientific analysis, and whatever you can throw at it. It can also be partitioned with second-generation multi-instance GPU technology to support up to 7 separate instances. There's a laundry list of notes associated with the installation of GPUs regarding fans, PCI slots, cable kits, storage options, and a bunch of other stuff. Tons of storage options, support for dual 4th generation Intel Xeon Scalable CPUs, and DDR5 memory and PCIe 5.0. Oh, and also GPU support with either 3 double-wide high-performance or up to 8 single-wide GPU accelerators. This system has a lot to offer. But if it's a bit too much, then there's always the HPE ProLiant DL360 Gen11 at 1U. If interested, check it out at itcreations.com. We have the ProLiant DL380 Gen11 in stock and that DL360 Gen11 too. It's okay to do a little window shopping too for other stuff you might need. Till next time, I'm Doug Stuman with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.